what every family needs. How would you complete that statement? What every family needs. Maybe you would say, well, what every family needs is a nice home to live in. Or what every family needs is parents who have good jobs and make a good living. Or what every family needs is to live in an area where there is a good school district in that location. Now, all of those things are good things and nice things, but is that really what every family needs as far as being the most important thing? Now, I don't mean today to be a prophet of gloom and doom, but as I look out today at a lot of Christian families that are under the attack of the forces of evil, and I see that many of them are disintegrating at an alarming rate, and I also see that many of these families that are disintegrating, they have a lot of these things, and yet they are still falling apart. It would lead me to say that I think there's something else that every family needs. And today on this Father's Day, that's what I want to talk about, and I believe that every family needs a dad whose name is David. That's what every family needs, because David was called a man after God's own heart. Every family needs a dad named David, a man who is after God's own heart. Dr. Jim George said to all of us as men, he said, as your heart goes, so goes your family. If your heart isn't right, no child-raising system, rules, or gimmicks will ever work. What an amazing statement that is that grips my heart. As your heart goes, so goes your family. And I tell you, when I read that statement, I want to make sure my heart is going in the right direction. If my heart is going to have a great influence on my family. I invite you to open your Bibles today, if you have them, to the book of Acts, chapter number 13. Acts chapter 13, and I want to look at only one verse of Scripture, and it's a verse of Scripture that is about the man that we're going to look at and try to pattern our lives after him in some ways as men. And even though I'm going to be speaking today primarily to the men in our congregation, here is a message that really everybody can learn from and apply the principles that we're going to be discussing. But in Acts chapter 13, verse number 22, the Bible says that when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse. And here is the statement, a man after mine own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. That ought to be the goal for every man that's in the service today, that we could be considered to be a man who is after God's own heart. A while back, a few months ago, in fact, one of our church members, Daniel Sherrill, he emailed me an article, and it was quite an informative article. And I'll not list all the names that were mentioned in that particular article, but basically what it was doing, it was listing and talking about the leading agnostics and atheists in the history of our country. And what was so interesting about that particular article is that all of those atheists and all of those agnostics, they had one thing in common. And what they had in common was they did not have a godly father in their lives to influence them. And I think what that tells us is that every family needs a father who is an authority figure in the family who will set an example of spirituality and morality. And if that family does not have that godly father that sets that example of spirituality and morality, then that family could very well be in trouble. Now, do not get me wrong and misunderstand what I'm saying today. I'm not saying today that if you are a single mom and you are doing your best to raise your children and you're really the only authority figure in that family, I'm not saying that there's no hope for you, that your children are going to turn out to be agnostics and atheists. I'm not saying that at all. But I'm simply highlighting the teaching of that article to point out to those of us who are men in the service today how extremely important the role is that we occupy in the family. And it is absolutely essential that those of us who are men in the family understand how important it is that we are involved on the battlefield for our family. Friend, I want to tell you, the family is under attack. Amen. I mean under attack like I've never seen it before. And there are so many forces of evil out there that want our families, want to wreck our families, want to destroy our marriages, want to steal our children. And it's vitally important that those of us who are saved men rise up, be men of God, and especially those men who are after God's own heart. Now, here's what I want to try to teach us this morning. What kind of heart is it that is a heart that is after God's heart? All we have to do is to look at the lessons from the life of David, because he is the one who was called the man after God's own heart. So if we are men after God's own heart, what kind of heart then will we have? There are three kinds of hearts that I want to mention that we draw exclusively from the life of David. Number one, I would say that a heart that is after God's heart is a heart that obeys. A heart that obeys. Every family needs a man in the house who knows and does the will of God. Every family needs a man whose yearning desire is to please God, whose passion of their life is to live in obedience to God. It is not simply something that's out there on the sidelines somewhere, out on the periphery of our experience, but it's something that is at the very core of our living. It is something that haunts us morning, noon, and night. We want to live in obedience to God. Now, here is what I have discovered as a man, and it may just be my own personal discovery, but I've discovered that, you know, when I got saved, I didn't just automatically wake up and overnight have this great desire to live in total obedience to God. It was something that I had to nurture my heart over the years to do. It was a process in my life, and I think that goes along with that spiritual process in the Bible that's referred to as the idea of sanctification, maturing, and growing. So I think that if we're going to have a heart that is after God's heart, a heart that obeys, then men, we've got to nurture our hearts. So how do we do that then? If we've got to nurture our hearts, how do we nurture them? I want to mention to us three ways that I believe that we nurture our hearts. Number one is simply the word that I would call devote. Devote. It all begins there. It begins with a devotion of our lives to Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. You know, the Bible says of the Lord Jesus that his meat was to do the will of him who sent him. In other words, Jesus would say, that which feeds me when I'm hungry is to do the will of God. In fact, did you know that it was said of Jesus in Matthew's gospel that he always did the will of God? He always did the will of his Father. And so if I'm going to have a heart that obeys, the first thing is I must have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ as my Savior and Lord. Now, I know that that's elementary, but I'm telling you, that's where it begins. And if it doesn't start there, it's not going to begin. The reason that I must have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ is because I must have the one living in my heart who always did the will of God, and it pleased his life to do the will of the Father. I must have that in order for him to live out his life through me. Because you see, the natural bent of my heart and the natural bent of your heart as a man, the natural bent of that heart is to do my will, not to do God's will. So I've got to have something in my life that overcomes that natural bent of my life. I've got to have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. So it all begins, first of all, with a devotion. A devotion, listen, to a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. But the second word is the word deal. The first word is the word devote. The second word is the word deal. If I'm going to have a heart that obeys God, I must have a heart that deals with my sin. Because a heart that obeys God is a repentant heart. You know, the one thing that we learn from the life of David, listen, that the tragic results that sin can have in a man's life. And we also learn the tragic consequences that can be the result of that sin in that man's life upon his family. We also learn from David's life how to recover from that sin once we have committed it. But men, I want to tell you, I could not talk to you today honestly about being a man after God's own heart if I did not talk to you honestly about dealing with sin. You remember what happened to David, don't you? David committed adultery with Bathsheba. And then to cover up the fact that he had gotten her pregnant, you remember that he had her husband murdered. And then David begins to tell us his story and what happened to him in his life for over a year as he refused to deal with the personal sin in his life. In Psalm 32, let me just read you these verses. Psalm 32, verse 3, when I kept silent, that is, when I did not deal with my sin, when I kept silence, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. For day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into the drought of summer. I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and mine iniquity have I not hid. So I said, I'll confess, I'll deal with my sin and my transgressions unto the Lord. And thou forgavest the iniquity of all my sin. David said, let me tell you what happened in my life when I did not deal with my sin. My body wasted away. I groaned in pain. My body was vitally drained. My strength was sapped. And yet the spiritual side effects of David's sin were worse than the physical side effects of David's sin. Because we read about the influence of David's sin that he did not deal with and what the result was on the life of his son Absalom. And his son Absalom grew up to be a rebel, and he tried to steal his own father's throne. And in the end, he lost his life. So I'm telling you guys, listen, if we're going to be men after God's own heart, we got to deal with our sin, and we've got to deal with our sin daily. Now, you may be thinking, well, I'm not a major league sinner like David. I mean, I've not committed adultery. I certainly am not a murderer. I mean, compared to David, I'm a pretty good guy. But the problem is, God doesn't compare our sin with David's sin. God compares our sin with his perfect righteousness. And you know, when we look at dealing with sin and think about it from that aspect, probably all of us have some issues in our lives that we need to deal with. Friend, I want to tell you, sin that is not dealt with hurts our relationship with God. Sin that is not dealt with hinders our spiritual growth. And sin that is not dealt with has negative consequences on the lives of our family members. That's why we must deal with our sin. You know, every child needs a dad who models before them not perfection, but models before them reality. What is reality? The reality is we all fall and we all sin. Amen? That's reality. And every child needs to see their dad modeling, not perfection, but reality. Why? So that those children can grow up learning to deal with reality. And they can learn how that they can repent of sin and do the right thing and be forgiven and move beyond it once they do sin, because, by the way, they are going to. But if they never see that example in our lives as the leader of the family, then they're not going to learn how to deal with it. Did you know what we do every time that we repent before our children? We teach our children how to fail successfully. And our children need to be taught how to fail successfully, because they're going to do it time and time and time again. And so we need to repent because our children need it. We need to repent because our own heart needs it, because our heart needs to obey God. And our heart can't obey God apart from repentance. Could you imagine what could happen just in this audience today if just the men who are here, if we would just take the mask off, If we would just, during the time of invitation, get real with God and before God, can you imagine what could happen if we would go home and we would just get real with our families? What could happen? We just might have revival in our families. And I want to ask right now, what sin right now is the Holy Spirit revealing to your heart or to mine that we need to deal with? Oh, it's not adultery, it's not murder, but what sin is he dealing with? You say, listen, I don't have any murder or adultery in my life. Great. But what about a bad attitude? What about a negative critical spirit? You know, what about bitterness? What about unforgiveness? What about anger? What about jealousy? What about spiritual laziness? What about a refusal to utilize the spiritual gift that God has given to us within the church to edify the saved and evangelize the lost? What is it that God is speaking to your heart about today as a man that you need to deal with? And so, first of all, if we're going to have hearts that obey, we must devote. Secondly, we must deal. But then thirdly, we must determine. We must determine. What must we determine if we're going to nurture our hearts to be obedient? We must determine that we are going to be discipled. We must make up our minds. We must put an exclamation point behind our commitment that I'm determining, I'm making up my mind, I'm settling the issue today. The determination of my life is that I am going to be discipled so that I can be a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Men, did you know? And ladies, did you know that we will never truly grow in the Lord until we become learners? The way that we are discipled is by being learners. And I want to tell you guys, listen, I don't mean to be ugly, but if your mind's already made up and you're saying today, you know, I don't need Sunday school, that's for children. I don't need much church. I mean, anything that I could possibly ever learn would simply be a rerun because I've already learned it all. If that's your attitude, then I want to tell you, you are in a place where, spiritually speaking, you are in trouble, and you are in a place where you have the potential of negatively influencing and impacting your family. Listen, we all need to be learners. And one of the greatest things that we could ever do to learn and to grow is to attach ourselves to someone who can lead us upward and onward to spiritual maturity. One of the best things that we could ever do is to find another man in our life who can be a model before us, set an example before us, who can lead us and guide us and direct us and counsel us and encourage us and even rebuke us on a regular basis. I have had the great privilege of having that in my life since I have been saved. I've always had two or three godly men that I could listen to, that would counsel me, that would rebuke me when it was necessary. One of the wisest things I've ever done when I came here was to ask God to put five men on my heart. Those five men are my accountability partners. We meet together once a quarter. We have lunch. We talk with one another. I share things with them that I don't share with anybody else. I give them the privilege to rebuke me if I need it, if they see something in my life that is not like Jesus. I'm telling you guys, that's one of the best things we could ever do. Let me ask you, is there somebody in your life like that? You know, I think a great example for this discipleship that I'm talking about, I think a great example of that is found in 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse number 2, when the Apostle Paul is speaking to young Timothy, and he said, "The things that thou hast learned of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also." As a Timothy, do you have a Paul in your life? As a Paul, do you have a Timothy in your life? You see, the Christian life is a lot like a relay race, isn't it? You're always handing off the baton. You're learning and then handing off the baton. Every time that a Sunday school teacher stands to teach a class, or a discipleship teacher stands to teach a class, or every time that I'm on this platform, that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to hand off the baton of what I have learned to others. And men, listen, that's a lifelong pursuit of ours. It ought to be learning and learning and learning and learning, so we can take that baton of our learning and we can pass it on to others, and especially to those in our families. And I believe that the greatest joy in growing old would be able to look back and know that you've taught your children spiritual truth. To see your children learn from you as a dad. To teach them about the things of God. But guys, we can't teach what we do not know. And we cannot know unless we put ourselves in a position of learning. Now, fathers, I want to ask us today, if you have taken yourself out of those positions where you could have learned, what kind of an example are you setting for your children? Now, the truth is, you know the answer to that. You know it, but the question is, are you man enough to deal with it? Are you man enough to deal with what you know? What kind of example are you setting before those children? You want them to grow up to be learners? Well, are you a learner? Am I a learner? And so the first word then is the word devote. The second one is deal. The third one is determine. What kind of heart is it that is after God's heart? Number one, it's a heart that obeys. But number two, it's a heart that prays. A heart that prays. You know, I challenge you to study the Bible, and you will see that contained within the Scripture, every man who had in his heart a desire to know God was a man of prayer. I think about Abraham. Abraham had a desire to know God. And the Bible says that Abraham throughout his life built altars and called upon the name of the Lord. Genesis 12 verses 7 through 8. Moses had a desire to know God. And the Bible says that Moses was constantly on his knees praying for God's direction as he led the nation of Israel. Exodus 34 verses 12 through 16. The man that we are following today, David. David had a desire to know God. And the Bible says that he prayed for forgiveness for his foolish decisions of numbering the people in 2 Samuel 24, verse number 10. He prayed for forgiveness after his sin with Bathsheba and Uriah. Solomon had a desire to know God. And the Bible says he prayed for wisdom. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse number 9. Daniel had a desire to know God, and he prayed a prayer of confession for himself and on behalf of his people, asking God to return the Jews to their homeland. Daniel chapter 9, verses 3 through 19. Nehemiah had a desire to know God, and he prayed for God's protection throughout the rebuilding of the wall in Jerusalem. Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 9. The apostles had a desire to know God, and they prayed for guidance after the ascension of Jesus. Acts 1, 14. The apostle Paul had a desire to know God, and he prayed constantly for the churches where he ministered. Friend, I want to be listed in the list of these kinds of men. They were all men of prayer. And so these people of prayer then tell us that if we're going to have a heart that is after God's heart, then we've got to be people of prayer as well. And that leads us to the second idea, and that is the priority of prayer. Friend, I want to tell you, every family needs a man who has a priority for prayer to be an important thing in his life. The most godly man I've ever known in my life was a man that prayed like no man I've ever seen. Now, when it comes to prayer, you might say today, well, Pastor, I want to tell you what, as far as my prayer life is concerned, there is no need for any improvement. Well, I want to tell you what, friend, if that's you, you're the exception. You're the exception. I can speak for me, and I believe I can speak for every other man in this room today. When it comes to our prayer life, there's need for great improvement. Great improvement. All of us can improve when it comes to our prayer life. And I don't know about you guys, but what I've discovered is that my greatest problem is allowing things to crowd out my time that I ought to be spending with God. It's a constant battle of my life. Is it a battle in your life? There's this constant battle of allowing stuff to crowd out the opportunities that are mine to spend alone with God. Guys, let me challenge you today. Pick you out a time to spend with God and stick with that time. Your time may not be like my time, but you pick you out whatever is your best time. My time is not 4 o'clock in the morning. If I tried to pray at 4 o'clock in the morning, I would simply snooze through my prayer time. I would not get anything accomplished. I am not awake at 4 o'clock in the morning. You may be. I still think that it's best to give the earliest time we can to God before we begin any other activities in life. What's the first thing that we do when we get out of bed? What's the first thing? Check our emails? Go to our iPhone? Read the newspaper? What's the first thing that we do during the day? Would you not agree that we ought to take some time for God? Pick you out a time. And then, guys, pick you out a place. You know, Jesus had a place. He didn't just pray when he was riding in the car. He didn't have cars in those days. If he would have, he wouldn't have done it. He had a place. Mark 1:35 says that Jesus went unto a solitary place, and there he prayed. I want to tell you, friends, there's something special about a place. And I am so grateful that God, early on in my life after I'd gotten saved, God riveted Isaiah chapter 26, verse number 20, into my soul, and it's still there today. You know what that verse says? That verse says, "Come thou, my people, enter into thy chambers and shut the door behind thee." Did you know that the word for chamber there is the word for holy of holies? And the Holy of Holies was the place where the presence of God was. That verse said to my heart, and it still says to my heart today, "Craig, come in to your special place. Shut the door. Get in secret. Get alone with me." That's what that was saying. Guys, I want to tell you what. If you will do what I'm telling you, it will revolutionize your life. Pick you out of time. Pick you out a place, a special place. That's your Holy of Holies. That'll become your place where you go every day to meet with God. That'll become the place where you go to battle out the great big decisions of life. That'll be the place where you go and you will lay down your heavy load. I love that place because I'm telling you, when I get all stressed out, weighed down, burdened down, and I have huge decisions in life to make, I can go to that place and I know that that's the place where I've met God time and time and time and time again. And I can lay down that heavy load. Guys, get you a time. Guys, get you a place. Gals, you do the same thing. Stick to it. Don't waver from it. And it will change your walk with God. I'm telling you, what every family needs is a man who prays, has a heart that prays. Guys, our families need us to pray for them. Amen. Man, our wives need us to pray for them. Man, our children need us to pray for them. And I've told my children this. If I could go back and do it again, the one thing I would teach you better than I taught you is how to pray. How to pray. What have we taught our children if we don't teach them how to get a hold of God? What have we taught them? What have we taught them? If we've not taught them how they can get a hold of the throne of grace. Because friends, I'm going to tell you, our children are growing up in a culture in which if they don't know how to get a hold of God, they don't have any hope. There's absolutely no chance. no shot in making it if they don't know how to get a hold of God. So guys, we ought to pray with our families. We ought to pray with our children. You know, that son or that daughter comes to you and they're having a tough time in life. Why not just put your arm around their shoulder and say, let's pray about it, son. Let's pray about it, daughter. Listen, that's for any age child. You know what you're teaching them? You're teaching them that they need God, and they can depend upon God, and they can trust God. And then after what you prayed for with your child, after you see God answer, what do? You come back and you thank God, and you're teaching them that God answers prayer. Friends, so many times the reason the church ends up the way that it does is because children, generation after generation after generation after generation, are getting further away from being raised in families that at one time had an old-fashioned family altar and prayed. And so it's become a thing that's just, you know, it's just not learned. It's just not common. So guys, with all of the burden of my soul, let me ask you, not only to have a heart that obeys, but to have a heart that prays, and teach your children to do that. But there is one thing about a heart that is after God's own heart. A heart that obeys, a heart that prays, and then thirdly, a heart that conveys. A heart that conveys. Conveys what? Conveys praise to God. If I were to ask you, tell me some things that you know about David. Did you know that most of us would probably bring up those macho things? That's all we think about when we think about David. Macho guy. He fought a lion. He fought a bear. He killed a giant. He led massive armies. He defeated many foes. His enemies were afraid of him. What a macho guy this guy was. He was a great general. He was a man's man. A leader's leader. A warrior's warrior. That's who David was. There is something else about David, I'm going to tell you, that every family needs, and it was not anything macho. You know what it was? David was called the sweet singer of Israel because he was always rejoicing and praising his God. David did not always do what was right, but the thoughts of God never were far from him. And we know that because of the lips of the praise that was on his lips continuously. He constantly praised God, rejoiced in his God. And that's what every family needs. Every family needs a dad who conveys praise. Did David really do that? Well, you decide for yourself. Psalm 7, verse 17, David says, I will praise the Lord according to his righteousness. I will sing praise to the name of the Lord Most High. Chapter 30, verse 4, sing to the Lord, O ye saints of his, and give thanks at the remembrance of his holiness. Psalm 33, verse number 1, rejoice in the Lord, O ye righteous, for praise is comely to the upright. Psalm 34, verse 1, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. See, David sets before us a good example. And that is that every family needs a man who is not afraid to verbalize his love for God. Don't you think that made a difference in his family and those that were listening to him? He was not afraid to verbalize his love for God. Friend, our families need to hear us as leaders of the family praising God in their presence. That's not a Pentecostal thing. That ought to be a Christian man thing. Unashamedly rejoicing and praising God. But what I've discovered is that most men need a little stimulation in order to verbally express their praise for God. So let me give you guys just a few stimulators that'll help you and help me to verbalize our praise to God. These things will help you. Number one, listen, meditate on God's power. Do you have a problem praising God? Meditate on God's power. Hardly a day passes that I do not think about the Apostle Paul's word in Philippians chapter 4, verse 13, when he was talking about the power of God that was available to him. He said in Philippians 4, 13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And you see, dear friend, as guys, we go through some stuff where we need the power of God in our lives. I mean, we face challenges, we face burdens, we face heavy loads, we face struggles, we face stresses, and it gets us down in the dumps. But when you truly believe with a convicted heart, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Friend, if you meditate on that and believe that, it'll put a rejoicing on your lips. Meditate on God's power. Number two, memorize God's Psalms. Memorize God's Psalms. Let me give you a good one to memorize. Psalm 118, verse number 24. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Do you think that that would not be an attitude lifter? If we went to work with that psalm in our heart being expressed from our lips every day, it doesn't matter what's in the day, God's made the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. What will I do? I will rejoice and be glad in it. Guys, there's so much to get us down in the mouth. And I talk to so many folks whose major complaint is, I was raised in a home where my dad always had such a critical and negative spirit. Just always down in the mouth about something. Guys, if we put Psalm 118:24 in our hearts, we believe that, and we say that, and we repeat that, and we meditate on that, we can't be down in the mouth and believe that at the same time. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let me give you an assignment. Next week when you come into church, rather than you with, you know, all the little kids in the back seat fighting on the way, recite that verse as you're coming to the house of God. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. As a matter of fact, I think that most of us need some help right now. Let's recite that verse together. Can you? This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Say it again. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Say it again. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Don't you feel better? Honestly, don't you feel better? God's word works. And when you put God's word in your heart like this verse, it works. Meditate on God's power. Listen, memorize God's Psalms. Master God's promises. There are over 30,000 promises in the word of God. And the sad thing is that most of us leave them on the pages. They can't do us any good on the pages. We got to put them in our hearts. Let me give you a good one to put in your heart. Psalm 68, 19. Praise be to the Lord, to God our Savior, who daily bears our burdens. What a promise. Think about all the burdens you have right now. The burden of making the ends meet. The burden of all the problems on the job. Maybe the burden with a child that is rebelling. Maybe a burden because there's just not enough money at the end of the month. Think about that promise. God daily bears our burdens. And there's a place that we can come and lay down our burdens. Number four, marvel over God's provisions. Marvel over his provisions. Philippians chapter 4, verse number 19, but my God is able to meet all of your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. If that were the only promise we had in the Bible, that would be sufficient enough to keep us praising God for the rest of our lives. God's provision. You have a need right now. You're worried about it right now. God has a promise for you. His provision. Trust him. And then last of all, you can mull over God's presence. Mull over God's presence. King David, when he was thinking about the presence of God, he just could not contain himself. And he broke out, I believe, in a psalm of praise. And fortunately for us, it's recorded. Now just think what came to his mind when he was mulling over God's presence. He said, O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my down sitting and my uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all of my ways. There is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thine hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, it is high. I cannot attain unto it. Where shall I go from thy spirit, or where shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there thy hand shall lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, even the night shall be light about me. Yea, the darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to you. Doesn't matter if it's day or dark, Lord, you're the same. You have possessed my reins. You covered me in my mother's womb, so I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My substance was not hidden from thee when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect, and in thy book all my members were written, which in continuance were fashioned, as yet this was none of them. How precious also are thy thoughts unto me, O God. How great is the sum of them. I can't count them all. They are more in number than the sand. When I awake, I am still with thee. In other words, here's what David was thinking. God, it's kind of rough down here. But God, it doesn't matter, because wherever I go, you are. God, whatever is happening, before I even get to the place of it's happening, you're already there. God, there's nowhere I can go to be out of your presence. Friend, do we praise God for his presence with us and our families? You know what that means? That means because we are in the continual presence of God, we are under the continual protection of God. Because there's nowhere we can go to get away from God. And the man of the family needs to be praising God continuously and teaching his family these vital and these amazing truths. Guys, here's what I'm saying. Let your family hear you praising God, rejoicing, thanking him. You can do it. Oh, yes, let that boy hear you say, great, when your team scores a touchdown. Let that boy see your excitement when you pull that bass into the boat. Let that boy of yours, let him take note of your gratitude when he's out on the golf course with you and you hit a ball, and for the first time in the last 2 hours, you've not had to shout, four! But let him hear you constantly saying, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Everything we have in our family is a blessing from God. As a matter of fact, if we can shout and holler and scream and yell over a stupid football or a fish or a little bitty golf ball, we can't say, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. We're not being men after God's own heart. You know, I think we could sum it all up by saying that the man who has a heart after God's heart is a man who has a worshiping heart. You know, we've looked at really the private aspects of worship, haven't we? But there are also some public aspects of worship. As a matter of fact, it's our responsibility as men to lead our families in that public aspect. David, our example, said in Psalm 122, verse 1, "I was glad when they said, 'Let us go down to the house of God.'" I was glad. I rejoiced to go down to the place of corporate worship. Men, it is our responsibility to keep our calendar clear on Sunday, to have our families in church to worship. It's not the wife's responsibility to make sure that church attendance happens. God holds us accountable to nurture our family's spiritual needs, and church attendance is part of those needs. That's what the Bible says. Did you know that the word church, ecclesia, occurs 115 times in the New Testament? 95 out of the 115 speak of the local assembly. God was big on the local church. The majority of the teaching of the Apostle Paul found in the New Testament centered on life in the local church. We will not have a heart for God if we do not have a heart for His local church. Am I the one leading my family, not only to attend church, but to involve my life in church? I close today by saying that I can almost hear God. I could almost hear God saying, "Give me a man after my own heart, whose faith is master of his mind, and I will right all wrongs and bless the name of all mankind. Give me a man after my own heart, whose tongue is touched with heaven's fire, and I will flame the darkest hearts with high resolve and clean desire. Give me a man after my own heart, one mighty prophet of the Lord, and I'll give you peace on earth bought with prayer and not a sword. Give me a man after my own heart, true to the vision that he sees, and I will build your broken shrines and bring nations to their knees." Am I a man after God's own heart? Are you a man after God's own heart? Our family needs us to be. That's what every family needs. Would you stand, please, with our heads bowed and eyes closed? And now it's decision time. No one looking around, heads bowed, eyes closed. Do you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? Starting point. Whether you're a man, woman, child, teenager, do you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior? If not, now is the time to respond and come. In fact, our ministers are down front. You can begin coming even as the invitation is extended. You don't have to wait until the choir begins to sing. Are you a man after God's own heart? Are there some decisions you need to make today? Are we men of prayer? Are we? Are we men who have hearts to obey? Are we men who have made up our minds and determined that we're going to be disciples of Jesus Christ? As a man, do you need to lead your family today to become a part of a local church, if not this one, some church somewhere? Is God speaking to your heart to just come to the altar to pray? Father in heaven, I pray in Jesus' name, God, that you will do a work in our time of invitation. God, I do pray that as men, that we will leave this service today, Lord, not with clenched fist, not with rebellious hearts, Lord, but with tender hearts, open to say yes to the leadership of whatever the Spirit of God has put in our hearts today. I pray that we might surrender to you, yield to you, say yes to you, Lord. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Heads bowed.